Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our correspondent, Penny Espinosa.
Hey guys, your news making headlines in the Filipino community.
Mr. Trump has repeatedly and consistently misrepresented and inflated the value of his assets.
We begin with New York Attorney General Letitia James saying the fraud case against former U.S. President Donald Trump will go on and that she will not be deterred by Trump's so-called distractions. James is leading the civil suit against Trump, alleging that he and his sons committed business fraud for years by inflating and deflating their company's assets. James is seeking $250 million in financial penalties and to ban Trump and his sons from operating businesses in New York.
At the end of the day, the only thing that matters are the facts and the numbers. And numbers, my friends, don't lie.
Trump complained of unfair treatment during a court testimony on Monday.
It's a case that should be dismissed immediately. The fraud was on behalf of the court. The court was the fraudster in this case.
Meanwhile, human rights lawyer and advocate Jose Manuel Chel Diokno is expressing alarm that another journalist has been killed in the Philippines. Radio anchor Juan Umalon was broadcasting from his home in Calamba, Misamis Occidental when a gunman shot him point blank. Umalon is the 199th journalist killed in the Philippines since 1986. The former senatorial candidate addressed this latest incident during his stop in Vancouver, saying human rights violations and extrajudicial killings have continued under President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.
We are calling upon government to really fast-track all investigations into these kinds of killings because we cannot have a nation where life becomes so meaningless and cheap.
Diokno is also worried about the government's attempts to erase the Marcos name from the history of martial law.
There was an announcement that the Department of Education had or will remove the name of Marcos from the textbooks in the discussion of martial law. And just a few days before I left, there was an announcement by Malacañang that the EDSA People Power, February 25, will be removed from the list of public holidays.
That is why Diokno said it is important to keep the memory of martial law alive. As chair of the Bantayog ng Mga Bayani Foundation, which runs the shrine, park, and museum that houses records and archives about martial law, he is asking overseas Filipinos for financial help so this can remain open. And finally in sports, the World Beach Ultimate Championships wrapped up this past weekend. And after sending four teams to compete in Huntington Beach, California, the Philippines is bringing home one medal. The Philippines will bring home a silver medal in the Grandmasters division after losing to Team USA in the Grandmasters finals 12-9. The Philippines also managed the fourth place finish in the women's division while wrapping up in fifth, both in the open division and mixed masters.
And those are the news making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website, YouTube channel, and app. I'm Henny Espinosa. Back to you guys at the rundown.
Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu says Israeli forces are now operating inside Gaza City as they press on with a month-long offensive against Hamas. In a televised statement, Netanyahu said there will be no ceasefire nor fuel delivery to Gaza without the release of hostages. He also warned Hezbollah against joining Hamas in the war. Meanwhile, Israel's defense minister says the country has no plans to rule Gaza once the war is over.
For me, this mission cannot be stopped until its achievements are reached. This war, which we were forced into, we won't go back nor stop. There is only going forward until Hamas is defeated and the hostages are returned. I can tell you who will not govern. It will not be Hamas, and it will not be Israel. Everything else is a possibility. And I want to say one more thing. At the end of this conflict, there will be no Hamas in Gaza.
A doctor at Gaza's Al-Shifa Hospital says Israeli attacks were getting closer to the complex every day. See, Israel has claimed Hamas is hiding tunnel entrances and operational centers inside Al-Shifa. The group has denied this. Doctors also insist only civilians are on hospital grounds.
The current situation is really getting tighter and tighter. So what we have been experiencing for the last month is that we feel they are coming closer to Shifa Hospital. And it's more of that we had many nights where they were bombing a lot of the neighborhoods near the hospital. The hospitals are usually protected by the international law, especially that we don't have military groups in Gaza, like obvious on the ground. You don't see anyone carrying a gun or weapon in the middle of Gaza. They might be there near the borders, but there is nothing like they can attack or military camp or something. So all the people here are civilians.
Gaza City's main hospital has turned into a giant refuge for civilians whose homes have been bombarded or who fear that they will be targets in Israel's military assault. So far, over 10,000 Palestinians, including thousands of children, have been killed in the war. A United Nations agency says services in Gaza are close to breaking point without fuel supplies. The UN Humanitarian Office says none of the nearly 600 aid trucks that reached the enclave so far were carrying fuel. The World Health Organization also appealing for the delivery of fuel to hospitals.
We're coming close to half of the available hospitals. As you've seen the reports, Al-Shifa Hospital reported that the solar panels on their roof had been struck too. That means the only remaining electricity source they had gone. Other hospitals have reported similar situations. So you ask, I think, when will we start to be critical or something like this? When will this start to be an issue? We're in the middle of it. More and more facilities are closing down. And more, life-saving means are closing down.
The evacuation of Filipinos from the war-torn Gaza Strip resumes. The Philippine Foreign Affairs Department says 46 of the 134 Filipinos in Gaza were allowed to cross the border Tuesday. These include 19 minors, 3 infants, and 2 pregnant women. The DFA also confirms the Palestinian spouses of Filipinos are now allowed to leave the enclave after gaining approval from Israel and Egypt.
Yun ang deal. They have to directly fly out of Egypt and go straight to the Philippines. So within 72 hours, yung nag-cross a border, kailangan ilipad papuntang Maynila na. So ganun yung magiging proseso. Yeah. They cannot stay in Egypt.
Meanwhile, some 42 Filipinos arrived from Israel Tuesday and more are expected to return home in the coming days.